And Twitch is a channel that streams video games.
Sure.
And the influencer, the so-called influencers who are getting the tens of thousands of people watching them talking about what, how to play a game. And we are trying to be cooperative and collaborative and change the world and try, you know, do good as educators. And our voices are not being heard. So maybe we're doing something wrong.
For me, I think that the main reason is the lack of training. Teachers lack training. See, they don't know how to join communities. They don't know how to participate in events. They feel, because I was involved in some local, let's say, communities, and we organized events, physical events. I discovered that the majority of them want to learn and want to attend events, but they don't know how to do that. So for me, my point of view is that it's the lack of training that hinders them, and let's say is an obstacle that we have to think how to solve it.
I want to take what Mubarak is saying about training and what Lucy has said about disillusionment and resources, teachers being in this resource deprived environment, and point to Hana, who is in Egypt, of which is and she's using a lot of energy to take teachers in exactly those two situations. And I don't know, Hana, you must be having some effect. You're certainly prolific. You're all over the place getting people organized. And tell us a little bit about the situation in Egypt and what you're doing to network people there and how you're networking with other people like me, for example. You've attracted me to your sessions, and I'm providing a Zoom room for you, and I'm quite happy to do it because it's such a worthy cause. But anyway, go ahead and tell us a little bit about what you're doing there in Egypt.
Thank you very much, Vance. Now, as I told you earlier, we had this problem of lack of impact, and it's like small numbers join free activities. We offer them free activities and they don't show up, which was so frustrating for us. When I started to think it over, I thought, well, we need to reach out to people in the best of ways that they can identify with. Interestingly, in Egypt, Facebook is so much popular, all right, for whatever reason, especially after 2011, it's been intensively used in various ways. So we just thought, why not? Okay, maybe we can turn it around and make it a professional tool. And the nice thing is, the more Facebook adds to its features, the better things have become on the ground. How so? For example, we started creating groups and people would subscribe. We had closed groups and then turned them into public groups. And they started, okay, these groups to attract people. They started to wonder who we are and would like to join us and would ask questions. First, we started by sharing videos, pre-recorded videos, and uploading them. People would just ask, okay, for, training and coming over and make a comment here and there. Later, with Facebook Live and how efficient it's become very accessible, to the point like it gives us access minute by minute to professional development events that we don't really provide in one place. Like, it used to be centralized around Cairo. Now we're going all over Egypt, so Upper Egypt, Lower Egypt, here and there. And it's worked. I mean, these points, which are not too many, I mean, since I started, it's like almost 9 events, all right, face to face. And you can just add to it some of those events we worked on virtually, 6 events so far, or maybe 7. So the point is, when people join and they share the word, we've increased the numbers, and that's the nice thing. I started getting like 100 plus people in face-to-face events, and that was the beginning. All right, so face-to-face events, and then you may go virtual and train people. If Greta would ask me, all right, what is the most powerful tool in your opinion, I would just tell her Facebook Live, because it's I saw it work in action. So it connected the face-to-face to the virtual, and it's like synchronous and asynchronous. So people would synchronously follow, share their comments on the spot while things are going on, or maybe go to the playbacks, okay, the recordings of these live Facebook videos, and would just wonder and ask questions about, you know, follow-up sessions, about, you know, how to join, how to conduct events here and there. People started inviting us for free because we have an issue with Nile Diesel. It's a nonprofit and it's a free community. We cannot ask for membership. So everything is done on volunteer basis, and you can imagine how difficult it is, but we're sort of funded in a very limited way to travel around. So we just pay presenters to commute around and maybe stay overnight for if it's too far away. But still, what you've just mentioned, I think that was Heike saying that it is, virtual events and conferences seem to be the most eco-friendly kind of tool. Online collaborations seem to be eco-friendly because they are low cost, all right? They don't really harm the environment in such a way like, gas and so on, and, you know, that pollution kind of thing that really, and of course, there are all kinds of pollutions around us in Egypt. You cannot imagine how bad it is. So it's sound pollution, it is air pollution, you name it. Okay, so to overcome that and change people, that's number one. We're after social change. So people, teachers, professionals are able to affect change first in themselves, then their students. Later on, we can discuss these, issues like climate change and how to be environmentally aware. There are those groups around Egypt that work on environmental change and climate change and saving animals and, saving, us as human beings. However, they're very few in numbers, and we don't have strikes for climate change around Egypt. You will hardly hear about that at the moment, although there are projects like recycling, although there are projects for you go to, for example, the American University in Cairo, they have this, okay, the recycle bins kind of culture, smoking kind of culture. It's one of, I would say, maybe the most exclusive community in Egypt where there is no smoking at all on campus policy. They've tried to enforce that policy over the years, I think over 10 years or so, and it never worked. All right, gradually but surely, it's like you cannot smoke indoors in the buildings. You stay away from the building like 100 meters, and then you have this closed area, and then okay, off campus, you want to smoke, you get out of campus. So these things happen. And
that's saying a lot for Egypt.
Of course. So you see what I mean? Affecting change and climate change is going to come at a certain point, but you need to train calibers, like Mubarak said. Calibers, people need to change first, and then you may consider these issues, but students are doing small projects, and we're really proud of them, really. So it's like people go and visit those like garbage recycling sites that are in Egypt. They help teach, they help paint buildings, they help clean up places, and they provide all kind of support. But still, these are very limited in scale. I would not say having a big impact to the extent that would be recognized. That's what I have for now. And back to you.